Beside him, for he knows what is ahead. Many things about world and lost in Satan's hand. You had nothing to gain by giving your life, knowing I could not repay you even if I tried. Still you walked to Calvary's mountain, still you hung on Calvary's tree, still you laid down your life, and you did it just for me. Still you shed your precious blood to wash me white as snow. Still you hold me in your head, and you'll never let me go. You knew that I would fail you from the start. Came to be. You came and lived a perfect life to set the captive free. The very life that you created cried out for your blood. Still you freely gave it all just to show your love. So you walked up Calvary's mountain, and then you laid down your life, and you did it just for me. Still you shed your precious blood to wash me white as snow. Still you hold me in your hand, and you'll never let me go. You knew that I would fail you from the start. Undeserving of your love, unworthy of such grace. Despite all I had done, still you took my place. And you hung on Calvary's mountain, and then you hung on Calvary's tree. You laid down for me. Then you led your precious blood to wash me white as snow, and you hold me in your hand, and you'll never let me go. You knew that I would fail you from the start. Still you love me. Still you love me. You love me with all of your heart.
All right, go with me tonight if you would to the book of Acts. Thank you, Miss Shirley, for minding the Lord. Miss Haley, thank you for the song. Thanks for being here at church tonight. We're so glad that you're here. And I'm throwing stuff all over the place. Be bad. I'm glad that you're here back on this Sunday evening. And I hope you had a, how many of you got a nap this afternoon? How many of you got a good one? How many of you believe that any nap's a good one? Amen. All right. Well, that means you're refreshed. You're good to go. But I'm certainly glad that you're back tonight. Let's do this tonight. You're in your place in the book of Acts. Go to chapter number 16. And once you find your spot, go ahead and stand. And I'm going to preach this. I'm starting a series. It's not a long series. I think it's 4 or 5 messages. It's where we'll land. I haven't really preached on this topic here in quite a while. And so I think it's something that maybe, I think it's something that we need to deal with, something that we need to address and touch on. And so I want to share this with you. I don't want to get too far ever in what we do from the main thing, from doing the main thing. I think churches have a tendency that we can migrate and do good things, but get away from the main things. And so I want to be very careful, be mindful of that, to make sure that we always keep that before us. And I think you find that here in the book of Acts. And so I'm just going to begin reading these verses. We're going to start reading in verse number 9. We're only going to read just a few verses, and we'll pray one more time, and you can be seated. The Bible says in Acts chapter 16, verse number 9, "And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. There stood a man of Macedonia and prayed him, saying, 'Come over into Macedonia and help us.' And after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. Therefore, loosing from Troas, we came with a straight course to Samothracia, and the next day to Neapolis, and from thence to Philippi, which is the chief city of that part of Macedonia and a colony, and we were in that city abiding certain days." Let's bow together for prayer, and I certainly hope that you'll pray tonight that God would keep our attention and God would teach us something, maybe challenge us about some things. And so let's pray together tonight. Brother Terry, how about take us, Lord, in prayer if you would. Amen. Thank you for standing tonight. You can be seated. These passages of Scripture that I'm planning on using over the next 3 to 4, 5 weeks, Sunday nights, are obviously, they took on a little bit of a new meaning to Libby and I when the church sent us to Greece. Because of the graciousness of the church, we literally got to walk these grounds where all this is taking place. We've got to see these sites. We've got to experience these things. And I know for us, it absolutely changed the way that we'll forever read these portions of Scripture. When you can go and you physically see the land and you physically see the landmarks and some of the things that were there when they were seeing this and when they were writing this are some of the things that we saw with our own eyes. And so I think it really, for us, it's a portion of Scripture that really comes to life, if you would. It's Paul's second missionary journey. He is headed into this area of Macedonia. If you know anything about Macedonia, Macedonia is not a city. Macedonia is an area. The northernmost portion of Greece is that area of Macedonia. And so Paul goes into this place and he begins to preach the gospel. But it wasn't because Paul had a desire at first to go there. Paul didn't just wake up and say, "You know what? I think I love it there." And we were talking to somebody the other day about missionaries and this, and we would laugh about this. But how many of you, we used to support one. How many of you have ever heard of missionaries going to Hawaii? I have. Now, we sat back and in our mind, we would say, "Man, if I'm going to go to a mission field, Hawaii is where I believe the Lord's calling me to Hawaii." That is one of the most difficult fields to raise support to go to. Do you know why? Because everybody thinks the way you just thought. Right? Sandy beaches, sun, you know, all the fruity, yeah. And so it would be a very difficult field. But you can see that being appealing to the flesh to, "Hey, I think I'd like to minister there. Those people need the Lord." And they do. They really do. But this was not the case. Paul didn't just wake up. Now, it wasn't that he was opposed to going there. But what I want us to see is this, is that God had to put something in his heart to get him there. God had to point him in that direction. And over the next 4 or 5 weeks, I really have a desire to kind of get back to the roots of things that we kind of, it was already instituted here, but kind of ran with, I guess, when we came some 21 years ago, and that is this subject of missions. The subject of missions. And so I'm going to be doing a series on Sunday night about missions. What are missions, or what is the significance of missions? Now listen, I'm not making a plea for your money. Don't decide, "Well, this is the last Sunday night, I'm going to be here for 5 weeks." I'm not making a plea for your money. I'm not making a plea for you to up anything or to give more, but I would tell you what I'm doing. My desire is to preach and show you the pages and the plainness from Scripture, and if the Lord puts it on your heart, I hope that you'll be open to do that which God puts on your heart to do. You see, if you do it for me, it won't last. If you do it for God, it won't end. I mean, that's the truth. As long as you're walking with the Lord, if you do it for Him, it's going to be fine. You say, well, preacher, I can't even begin to think about that or fathom it. Well, let's just look at the Scripture because God may open your eyes to some ways that you can become involved in a mission program in a way that you can be part of that, because I do believe, I'm convinced of this, that missions are the heartbeat of the Lord. But souls of men are the heartbeat of God. And so I want us to see some things tonight, and we're gonna dive right in. I'll address this tonight, this series of messages or this topic for many of those that are involved in this church or have been involved in churches. Missions is probably a very familiar topic. It is something that we have missionaries come by. We support missionaries. We read mission letters. We give mission updates. Many of you follow our missionaries on social media platforms. And so missions is not something that is foreign to your ears. And that's a good thing, by the way. That's a good thing. However, I don't want you to allow the familiarity of it to rob you of the challenge as that what may God take you from this point forward. All right, and so I want us to see this because I believe that it's needful still yet, even in our churches today. Mission messages, if we're not careful, can become so cliche. They can become so familiar that we kind of even disregard them. Well, I'm doing my little part. I'm doing this. And we really don't consider the weight behind that which missions is all about. And so, we put a little money in the plate. We mark an offering envelope somewhere. And when we pray, we say, Lord, remember all the missionaries. Bless all the missionaries in Jesus' name. And we feel that we've done our part. But if we're not careful, we'll lose the significance of what missions is really all about. And just a while back, I had the opportunity. And some of you all that came by to support me, I appreciate that. But I had the opportunity to preach a missions conference at our home church at Turner Street. And something I never thought I'd ever do. I know some of the caliber of men that stood in those pulpits and preached missions conferences. And so I dealt with many of these things. And so if you were there one or some of the nights, some of this stuff may sound familiar. So you just nod and smile and if you heard it. But I want to share it with our people because I think it's necessary. All right. And so let's look at a few things tonight. But I want to talk about this topic. And when he says here in verse number 9, the very first verse that we read, it says, and a vision appeared to Paul in the night. And a vision appeared to Paul in the night. And so we're going to talk about this tonight, the vision of missions. The visions of missions. And really, if you get down to narrow this down, we're going to talk about the value of having a vision for missions. You see, without any kind of mindset or goal or aspirations of what missions is all about, missions will never get accomplished. Unless we see the necessity of it and the need of it, there's never going to be a mission project. There's never going to be a mission program. Where did Paul get into Macedonia? Where did it begin? We'll say, preacher, it started on the road to Damascus. Okay, you can get a sticker. You got one for the choir. You can have one for that. Okay, yes, it started at the conversion of the Apostle Paul. Okay, I get that. But Paul was already preaching. He had already been on one entire complete circuit of a missionary journey. What then? You say, well, it's just the next place that Paul wanted to go. Not so. You'll find that in this passage of Scripture. This is not where Paul had wanted to go. And so how then did God get the gospel to the Gentile people in the area of Macedonia into Europe, as a matter of fact? Where did that begin? It began in verse number 9 with something as simple as a vision. Now listen, I am not telling you that you ought to pray that God wake you up in the middle of the night and on your ceiling you're watching this scene play out. That's not what I'm talking about. All right? But God worked in the heart of the Apostle Paul to get him where he wanted him to go. All right, and so this vision superseded Paul's will for his life in order that he might accomplish God's will for his life. You see, We need that. We need that direction. We need that leadership and that guidance so that we can be where God wants us to be. Now, it's not a strange thing that God did continually use visions as a means of showing those the direction and instruction. Abraham had a vision. Samuel had a vision. Prophets had a vision, had visions. Peter had a vision. We talked about that this morning. Peter had a vision. Here, Paul had a vision. And again, we're not looking for visions from the sky. We have something they didn't. We have the complete word. We have the book. We know this certain things to be God's will. And so we understand that God has given us a commission. We understand God has given us a charge. We understand that God has equipped us to do this job, but we need to be reminded of that. And so we see that in Scripture. Now, from the happenings of verses 9 and 10, Paul arrived at this conclusion. You say, what is it? Without a doubt, God wants me, God is calling me to go into Macedonia. Now, that it was this, and I'm not trying to be funny, it was as clear as day. It was as clear as day to Paul. After verse number 9, after Paul had received the vision from God, it became clear that this is what God wants for me. You know what would be awesome after we preach this series is if you read the purpose behind missions and we talk about all these things and we'll talk about a vision of missions, we'll talk about the voice of missions and there were several things that we'll talk about over the next few weeks. But if we get to the end of that, it'd be an awesome thing is if you see personal responsibility and say, hey, without a doubt, God wants me involved somehow, some form, some shape, some fashion in this business of missions and seeing people come to know Jesus as our Savior. And so without a doubt, God wants me and God is calling me to Macedonia. What's he say? Assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us. All right, that's verse number 10. Assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us. That phrase called means to put together in one's mind. I'm comparing one thing to another and I'm sure that God is leading me to consider this. I'm assured that this is what God wants me to do. All right, so let's look at a few things this evening, and then I'll let you go. We'll go next door. Understand that without this vision, it's likely that Paul would have never ended up on his own will and own doing in this little place of Macedonia. You say, why is that significant? You understand that Macedonia is in Europe. You do realize that we are descendants of Europe. You understand that not me, preacher. Well, the most of us are descendants from Europe. All right, you say, well, why is that important? Why is that significant? Our culture is our descendants of Europe. Why is that so significant? Because the first touch of the gospel message that was preached because God gave Paul a vision to go into Macedonia. The first European convert is listed in this very chapter after Paul stepped foot in Philippi. The first European convert was made, and from thence the Gentile church in Europe was born because Paul saw a vision. You see, all kinds of possibilities are there if we'll just listen to what God would have for us in these things. So a vision is imperative. All right, so let me give you two or three things about these visions, and then we'll go to the house. Number one, the vision that Paul got was received as personal. As personal. The Bible said the vision came to who in the night? Came to Silas, right? No. Well, it came to Barnabas, right? No. It came to Paul at the night. That means it was very personal to Paul. You see, in order for you to get involved, in order for you to embrace this thing and to be a recipient of what God is trying to teach us, you're going to have to understand there is a personal, we're going to have to receive it as a personal challenge or a personal charge in our lives. Now, why is that significant? Well, let me tell you why, because, listen, preachers can talk to you about a lot of things. Any time that a missionary comes by, he wants you to support his work, right? He is going to that field. Hey, I need your support. I want your support. And so he gets up and he begins to share his burden. He begins to share what God has done in your heart. But it's not only missionaries. Think about how much the world is vying for your attention, your time, your money, and good causes. I'm not talking about weird stuff. I'm talking about really good causes. You know, so you're going to have to figure out what is it that God wants for me to do. Well, you were going to have to receive the vision, if you would, as personal. It's a personal calling in verse number 9 and verse number 10. We've got to realize that God has calling you. Now, again, God may not be calling you to Macedonia. But then again, God may be. And we don't hear a lot of preaching on actually God calling young people and God calling older people. By the way, God still calls adult people, grown people, established people. Absolutely. He does. God still calls. You know, it's a sad day that we find less and less, it seems, that anybody are even open to the possibility that God may be calling you somewhere. Think about it for just a minute. What if God doesn't want your money? What if God wants you? What if God said, you can keep your money? I don't want a dime that you have. I just want everything. I want you. I want you to sell everything you've got
And I want you to be able to go, and I'm calling you to a field, and I want you to go to this place, and I want you to invest your life into giving the gospel to somebody. Some of you are reaching for your wallet already. You say, why? Because it's a whole lot easier to give in our mind than it is to go. But what if God don't want your money? You see, we'll consider certain things. Now all of a sudden I can preach on giving and y'all amen. I'm telling you, God's got a plan and God's got a program. And Paul wanted to go to Asia. Paul wanted to go to Asia. God said, you can't go to Asia. Why? I want you to go to Macedonia. And so he had to embrace this vision as personal. God is calling Paul specifically. I'm talking to you. I want you to go to this place. Well, let me ask you tonight, what is it that God is leading you to do? He said, preacher, God ain't leading me to do anything. I'm just fine where I'm at. You might need to listen a little closer. God's not leading me, preacher. God's not, he ain't telling me anything. I hadn't heard anything. I've never even considered it. You might want to read a little closer. You see, there's something that all of us, that God has called us as far as the furtherance of the Great Commission. There's something for us to do. There's some form or fashion. I'm not here to designate the amount of money that you're supposed to give. That's not my job. I'm not here to tell you the amount and the area of service that you ought to be serving and how much you're supposed to be or not supposed to be doing. But you need to embrace this, that God has something definitively for me to do, and I'm going to find out what it is. All right, so it was a personal calling. It was a personal calling. God had entrusted some of these men. He had entrusted these men to go out and to preach the gospel. Do you realize this evening that God has given us a gospel message that he's entrusted to us who are part of the church? With this message, to share the message, to give the message, to get the message to a lost and a dying world. And so Paul received it as personal. Notice this, Paul didn't have to ask Peter what he should do. No one ever said that Paul consulted Peter. You know, he never picked up his phone and texted Peter and said, Peter, I really need your advice. He never did that. Why? He embraced this vision as personal. God let me know this is what I'm supposed to do. He didn't check with Silas to make sure it was okay. No. The vision was to Paul. It was specific and it was personal. The responsibility and charge, the spark of your involvement is going to begin with an understanding that God is revealing to you the mission that he wants you to be part of. You know, God can make it plain. He really can. God can make it plain. God can make opportunity plain. God can challenge your heart as to whether or not he wants you to be involved. Listen. You say, well, preacher, I just can't afford it. Well, again, I'm not vying for your money, but let me tell you, you do understand that you're talking to God who fed 5,000 with 5 loaves and 2 fish. You're talking to a Savior that looked, and all those people were putting that money in to the coffers and putting the money into the offering plate, and he noticed that one who gave 2 mites, and says she gave more than the rest of them. Listen, he's not interested in the amount; he's interested in the participation. It's not about the amount. It's about the participation and about obedience. You say, well, I can't do much. Listen, you're way underestimating what God can do with what you have. You're way underestimating God. You say, well, preacher, I'm just a kid. There's nothing I can do. You're way underestimating the value and the power of the God in which we serve. Listen, everybody can be involved if you'll seek God and pray God. Take it personal. Find some place, find something to get involved and be part of this work that God has led us and called on us to do. I'm telling you, everybody can be involved in that. Now, so it's also not only to be received as personal, but it's also to be carried out practically. Now, here's the unique thing. You know, Paul was sort of like the man in charge, right? When you read, they took these trips and they were in these cities. Paul was pretty much the spokesman. Hey, we're going to go over here. Okay, yes, sir, Paul, we're going to go. Okay, now we're going to leave this city and we're going to go over here. Okay, yes, sir, Paul. And here's what's going to happen. I'm going to stay here, but you're going to go back up there. Yes, sir, Paul, we'll report back. Paul was kind of like the leader, if you would, of this crowd. But they were a team. They were a team. And so to carry out this mission, this worldwide mission, it's going to take not only an individual, but it's going to take a team of individuals. Now, listen, I'm not trying to give you a sales pitch and try to be corny about it, but I want you to understand this. You can't go to every single country in this world. You can't do it. You can't do it. You're not going to be able to go to all these places and all these cities and all these towns and this village and on this countryside and to this group, people group and to that people group. And you're not going to be able to learn all the languages and do all that. You say, well, what's it going to take? It's going to take a team of people. How do we carry out missions practically? Well, it's not only that we must consider that God has calling us particularly or personally, but a practical way of carrying that out is with support. It is with prayer. It is with finances. It is with mission trips and going to this place and that place and making sure people get to this part of the country when God partners us up together. Notice this team effort. Listen to what they said. The Bible said, and immediately after he had seen the vision, immediately we endeavored to go. Listen to the wording in that. He saw the vision, but we got on board with the vision and we endeavored to go. Who saw the vision, class? Paul. Who decided to go with him? Paul's companions. All right, and so it was a team. How do we carry this out practically? You're going to find this later, and we talked about it maybe a little bit when we were preaching through the book of 1 Thessalonians, but you'll find out that when Paul came to Athens, Paul had sent his traveling companions, Timothy and Silas, he had sent them back to Thessalonica, right? So he had a group that toured, that went with him, that traveled with him, and so they were carrying out this mission. And so when Paul said, hey, change the plans, fellas. Change the plans. We're not going into Asia. God said go to Macedonia. They didn't argue with him. Okay, Paul, if you're sure, we're trusting you, we're going to follow your leadership. Paul, we're going to go with you. How do we carry it out? Listen, it's going to take a team effort. Again, I'm not trying to become a cheerleader. I'm not trying to get you to drink the Kool-Aid. I want you to understand this. That's how missions work. Missions has always worked that way. Do you realize that from the early church, the church that's going to be established in Philippi in just a couple verses, do you understand that that church caught the vision of missions and who in their poverty, they sent money from one place to another place in support of worldwide missions? Why? They got involved in the effort, but it was a team effort. They got involved. We're talking about a young church. You understand that churches gave in, even the church of Thessalonica, into the mission, into the effort, which is how we carried out missions practically. So we're going to have to count it and receive it as personal. Second thing tonight, when we talk about this vision, realize this: it's about people. It's about people. You know, projects are easy to get behind. Projects are easy to get behind. Really, I mean, building projects. I like building projects. I'm not against building projects. I'm not against helping. But projects are easy to get behind. Put a little money into it. They build a structure. You see it. You say, man, mission accomplished. That looks great. That's awesome. We had a part in that. And there's a place for that, right? There's a place for that. But missions are more than just about buildings. Buildings come. Buildings go. Buildings rise. Buildings fall. The real heart behind mission. The reason that they build buildings is because there's people who need a place to worship. Missions are about people. 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 That shouldn't be that foreign to us, right? But I was thinking, when I was putting this message together, I got to thinking about this. Missions is not about your money. Now, does it take money? Sure it does. When's the last time anybody's ever bought a plane ticket? When's the last time? Did they just give it away? No. By the way, one of the only things to get about COVID was the travel time to Charlotte and plane tickets were cheap. Man, you could get to Charlotte and back. Man, nobody's on the road, Brother Terry. I didn't need the little toll money. I didn't need all that. All right, and plane tickets were cheap. I mean, they were. They could, you know, we could fly. $150 plane tickets. Man, that's awesome. All right, price them now. Price what it costs to, we just move. Price what it costs to rent just a small moving truck to move from point A to point B. It ain't cheap. Rent's not cheap. Language school's not. So it costs money, but missions is not about money. It takes money, but it's not about money. Let me give you this as a side note. This is not really about the vision. This is just about the operation of missions. Be careful when you hear how much a missionary is trying to raise. Okay, they're not crooks. Okay, the good ones are not trying to live above their means. You do understand that when a missionary gets to the mission field, he in essence becomes the supply line for that local body. So he's paying the rent on the assembly, a place to assemble. He's buying the songbooks. He's taking care of the material. He's buying the vehicle to go pick up the kids to bring them in. He's putting the gas in there. He's paying for his electric bill. He's paying the light bill for the church. He's buying supply. So understand that if they come in and say, well, how much are you needing monthly? And he throws out this number, and you're like astronomically flabbergasted. Well, I don't live on that. Well, okay, this building was built when you got here. Okay, we're not. It's not. You're not footing the bill for that. Now, why is that? Why did I say all that? Well, let me just listen. They're not crooks. It's not about the money. It's not about the money. Are there some that's dishonest? Sure, sure. Are there some Baptist people that steal from the Lord? Sure. They're not. You say, well, preacher, what are you trying to say? I'm trying to. It's about people. It's about people. All right. So it's not about money. It's not even really about programs. It's not about social well-being. It's about people. When we talk about biblical mission, I am for helping people. But do you understand that you will never be able to cure the social ailments of the world? I was talking to one of our missionaries, Brother Keith Shoemaker. It's been years ago now. And Brother Keith was telling us that one of the hardest things that when you go to a country, Brother Keith's in Burkina Faso, for those of you that are not really familiar, Brother Keith's in Burkina Faso, Africa. And he said one of the hardest things that when you go onto a field like that is there's so much poverty and there's so much sickness and disease and there's just, I mean, it's everywhere. They don't have water. Disease is rampant. Their health is terrible. Their hygiene is awful. And he said immediately what you want to do is you begin to want to help these people. You begin to want to make sure that they have clean water. And that's a good thing, by the way. And they've done that and used it for a great tool of ministry. They've drilled some wells in those places. But he said, you want to help them. You want to get them the medical care that they need. You want to treat their sickness and all that. But he said, here's the reality. Here's the reality. You're not going to be able to cure all of them. You can't do that. You're not going to be able to feed all of them. You're not going to be able to support all. Your resources are so limited. You just can't do it. He said, but what you can do, he said, you can give them all the gospel. You can tell them all about Jesus Christ. You can love them. Listen, this world's temporary. And you can prepare them for the next life because you've got the truth of Jesus Christ. And so you've got to keep a perspective of what it is. Are they helping people? Absolutely. But listen, it's about the souls of men. It's about the souls of men. And so when Paul is getting ready to go into this place, he is not trying to change them socially. I think one of our failures as far as the American church is, I think we far too often we try to Americanize the foreign field. We try to make them do things. They're not American. There's a reason. They're not a part of this culture. You know, they don't need an Americanized church. They just need to know Christ and they need to have a church, right? They need to assemble as a church. And so if we're not understanding, we're just trying to make them fit our little form. That's not the call of missions. The heart of missions was to teach them about Jesus Christ. It's to give them the gospel. So it's about people. It's about people. What did God show Paul? This is simple. This is not a trick question. What did God show Paul? Did he show him a map or did he show him a man? He showed him a man. He showed him a man. On the first slide that we have, and even in the bottom, you know what we have? We have a world. We have a map. That's what we associate. That's missions. But let me tell you, God didn't show him, Paul, I want you to go to this area on the map. He said, no, Paul, here's a man that needs the gospel. This man says, come over and help us. Come over. We're in a bad way, Paul. Come over and help us. And so he showed him a man. Why? Missions is not about a place on the map, but it's about men and women and boys and girls, children who are lost and undone without Christ, who need Jesus Christ to have a hope of tomorrow. So missions are about people. Now listen, we don't know the identity of the man, but we do understand the idea behind him. He saw a person, a specific people. Again, listen, maps change. Countries are conquered, renamed, divided. A lot even went since Paul's day. But man, the condition of the need of souls have been the same ever since the fall of man. People need the Lord. People need the truth of Jesus Christ. Listen, whether they have a dime in their pocket or whether they have millions of dollars in the bank, they still need Jesus Christ. It's the same essential need. Listen, whether they have dirt floors or whether they live in a mansion with gold sinks in their bathroom faucets, they still have the same need. They need the Lord. They need Christ. They need Jesus Christ. And so it's about people, but he saw people specifically. Man, think about this. Jesus was not moved by maps. Jesus was moved by men.
Jesus was moved by people. Paul here, moved by people. Philip, over in the book of Acts, chapter number 8, was moved. He was led by the Spirit to a who? To a man of Ethiopia. Right? Peter was moved. He was sent to God, to the house of Cornelius that we talked about this morning. He was moved by a man, by an individual. Missions about people. It's kind of ironic. It's in my notes. It's in my notes. Brother Mac. Brother Mac came by. When he came by our place, if anybody remembers, he coming by. Again, one of the best presentations I've ever seen. I've seen a lot of missionary presentations. He had one of the best. But he was talking about the people that we saw on his video. Y'all remember it? And he said, listen, these are not generic pictures. He said, these are people that I've personally met. I know these people. I've won many of them to Christ. I can take you to where they're at now. I can take you to their homes. I can take you to the spot where they come to know Christ as their Savior. I can take you to where they were baptized. I can take you to the places they're being discipled. They were real people who were real in his mind. It's in my notes. That illustration is in my notes. And I'm telling you, I got the letter after the notes were typed. Missions are about people. Missions are about faces. They're about needs. And they were moved by people. Why do you think it is that all these people want your money, play these sad songs and show you these sad faces? You know why? Because it pulls your heartstrings. It pulls the heartstrings. Listen, I'm not trying to pull your heartstrings, but if you really see people, I was thinking about this afternoon. Man, and you talk about conviction. How many people do we pass every day? Do we pass every day and we're really not moved by them? Think about the condition of our nation. Most of the time, we're moved because we're indignant, we're mad. But how long has it been since our heart's really broken for the people of our country? I mean a genuine brokenness because people are lost and going to hell. A genuine concern because people do not know Jesus Christ, and we have the truth, and yet we're not moved enough even to make ourselves a little uncomfortable and tell them about Christ. We're not moved enough to inconvenience our schedule, our time, just to take 2 minutes and tell them about Christ because we're just too busy. Listen, I'm telling you, missions are not just about a map. It's not just about money. Missions are about men. It's about people. And we need to understand this. That's what moved the heart of Paul. I wonder if the Lord would work in our heart to pray about giving or going when we see a man rather than just a dot on a map. He said a man. He witnessed his plea. He heard his plea. Verse number 9, he said this, come over and help us. Come over and help us. And I'm convinced there's still men, women, boys, and girls that are still crying out, come over and help us. Help us. Give us what we need. We're in need of something. Many don't even know what they're in need of. But will you hear their plea? We're blessed to live in this country. I know it's not perfect. I know it's warped. I know there's a lot of crazy stuff that goes on. I'm going to tell you, we're blessed to live here, to have heard the truth. Most of us have heard it over and over and over. We've heard it so much that we've become dull to it. We've become callous to it. But there's literally a world filled with people who've never heard the name of Jesus Christ. They've never heard the hope of the gospel. They know that there's something missing. They know that there's something that's not satisfied. But yet they've never heard the truth of the gospel. There's a plea. I wonder if we're even listening to what that plea might be. He received it as personal. He realized it was about people. Let me give you the third thing. What about requirements of progress? If I'm going to progress in this thing of missions, if I'm going to actually have a part in this, what are the requirements for this to progress? Well, number one, it requires committed obedience. Look at verse 11. Therefore, loosing from Troas, we came with a, look at this, straight course. Once you know to do it, do it. We came with a straight course. We didn't alter. We didn't veer. We didn't take our time. We immediately endeavored to go there. You say, what is that? I wondered, what if God was to just pull back the veil of the curtain of your eyes and say, listen, this is exactly what I want you to do. Would you immediately do it? Or would you argue? Would you, oh, God, I don't know about that. Now, I'm not saying don't make sure. I'm not telling you, we can make a lot of mistakes when we make them emotionally. But when God solidifies in your heart, maybe it's not what to do, but maybe it's just the fact that there's something that you ought to do. Will you take that first step and say, okay, God, I'm willing. God, if you'll show me. God, I'm telling you right now, I'm willing to go. I'm willing to do it. God, all you got to do is show me, but I'll take the first step. Until you show me, until you make it clear, I'm committed. It's going to take committed obedience to carry out missions. Loosing from Troas, we came with a straight course. Where did Paul want to go, class? Asia. God said, you're not going to Asia. You're not going there. Why not? Because there was a man in Macedonia. And so immediately Paul said, listen, I saw this man come over and help us. We assuredly gather that God has called for us to go and to preach the gospel to him. To go and preach the gospel. And so they came. It's going to take immediate committed obedience. It requires optimal consideration. Would you actually consider, we endeavored to go. I said, preacher, I ain't seen a vision like Paul. Well, okay, I get that. And by the way, I'd be concerned if you told me you had. I don't think God's going to come and show up in your room late at night and talk to you like something spooky. I don't believe that God's going to operate that way. But if you look at it, Luke, Silas, and Timothy, according to the context of Scripture, the reading of Scripture, they didn't see the vision either. They just assuredly gathered, if God's calling him, God's calling me. God's put us together. God's made us a team. And if God's calling Paul, God's leading me. And if he's going, I'm going. They assuredly gathered. Optimal consideration. And then continual action. I said this earlier, so I'll hit this and we'll jump on the last thing. But this wasn't Paul's first missionary journey. Okay, Paul had already been on a mission trip. He'd already been there. As a matter of fact, he'd run into some complications at the end of the road. This was right after Paul and Barnabas had parted ways. Paul and Barnabas part ways in chapter number 9. You'll find that there's a little contention, or in chapter number 15, there's a little contention between Paul and Barnabas over John Mark, and so therefore they part ways. That was at the end of Paul's first missionary journey. In fact, they were getting ready to make the circle back to check on those churches that were established and those new believers when they had a break in that fellowship. And Paul chose Silas and Barnabas took John Mark with him, and they all went their separate ways. And they made that circle, that circuit. And then Paul said, now from here, let's go out again. And he said, no, you're not going to Asia. You're going to Macedonia. You see, what are you trying to say? I'm telling you, missions is not just a one-time thing. It is a continual action for us to be involved in. Why? Because until Jesus comes, people are continually, always going to be in need here in the gospel. I'm finding this out. As people pass off the scene, more people are coming on the scene. Sure are. As people pass off the scene, man, there's more coming on the scene. And they're going to keep coming. What you say, what do they need? They need the gospel. They need Jesus. All right, so continual action about that. You see, well, preacher, missions is not something that we support missions. We give apart from our tithe, and we've done that for years, and we give whatever God's laid on our heart, and we pray for our missionaries and all that. And I don't, what more do you want us to do? Well, here's what I want you to not do. I don't want you to stop. I don't want you to come to a season in your life and you say, okay, listen, that's enough of that. I'm gonna move on to the next thing. No, it's a continual process. God never calls us not to tell people about Christ. God never calls us never to be involved in a corporate program to see missions go further throughout the cause of Christ. There's a partnership in that. I wrote this down. Don't let the success of the past cloud your judgment of the potential of the future. What if Paul would have got back and said, you know what, man, I'll just be honest with you. I've had about enough of this mission thing. And, you know, I paid my dues, I made my trip, and I did all that. But, you know, God, I'm not going to Macedonia. I know they need the Lord, and I know they need it, but let somebody else do it. I'm just done. No, don't go backward. Don't stop. Don't take your foot off the gas, if you want to look at it that way. We've got to go forward. Missions is so necessary in the cause of Christ. And then we need a renewed perspective. The latter part of verse number 10 says this. He said, immediately we endeavored to go into Macedonia, assuredly gathering that the Lord had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. To preach the gospel unto them. We made this statement about Paul being the team leader. Let me just read down through here and I'll give you what I'm thinking. The renewed perspective is this. As Paul was a team leader, he wanted to take Timothy, right? Acts chapter 16, 1 through 3, he's the one that picked up Timothy and said, Timothy, I want you to come go with me. Go back to the first part of that chapter, you'll see that. All right, so he wanted to take Timothy. It was Paul who had decided to part ways from Barnabas and not to take Mark. All right, So you say, what is it? They had agreed to go along and to follow the leadership of Paul. Now listen, I'm not telling you that you do this because I say to do this. Don't miss this. But from a team perspective, understand Hope Baptist Tabernacle has a purpose. Hope Baptist Tabernacle has an opportunity to work together in this thing of worldwide missions. And so as people come by and God puts people on my heart and I present people before you, listen, I don't bring every missionary before you that comes by and drops by and calls, and I just don't do that. I just don't do that. There might be services that we have missionaries come by, and I may recognize them, I may call them, but they may not come up here and talk. Listen, I want to get who God wants us to have, right? I want those to be the people. I'm not saying they're bad people. Somebody comes and says, well, preacher didn't have him say anything. That's not it. He might be a great guy with a great ministry. There might be people that come by and present, and we never take on for support. Great guy, great ministry. I just maybe didn't have the leadership of the Lord that now is the right time to support them. But what I'm saying is this, is we need to be together in this thing of missions. I believe that missions is a corporate action and should be a portion of corporate action, and I'll explain what I'm saying. I know it's different. I know I'm more talking, but I want you to understand my heart. As a local body, I think we do things as a church under the authority and the umbrella of the church. So as we agree, that's why we bring missions before. We bring a missionary before. That's why we vote on things. That's why we vote to support. Why? Because when we vote to do that, you are committing that we are going to support this missionary through the channel of the local church. Right? You say, well, preacher, I send so-and-so so much money, whatever. That's between you and the Lord. But from a corporate standing, we support missionaries through the church. Notice their perspective on this was, hey, listen, if this is the direction that Paul wants to go, then we believe that God is leading him. We're going to follow that. And corporately, we're going to be collectively together in this thing of missions. I believe that's where a church needs to be. We need to be collectively together. We can support our missionaries together. We can pray for our missionaries together. We can visit our missionaries together. And so I think there's a corporate significance in that. After he saw the vision, immediately we endeavor to go. God gave Paul clarity, right? God gave Paul the vision. But corporately, they worked together to accomplish the goal of going to Macedonia and reaching people for Christ. Now, again, you're likely never get a vision like Paul did. I'm never going to get a vision like Paul did. I didn't get one on the road to Damascus. I didn't get one when I got born. I didn't have like an epiphany of the clouds roll back. But what I do have is a clear-cut premise from the Word of God that there are still people who need help and there are still people that need the gospel. When Paul went, what did he do? He went and preached the gospel. When he went to Rome, in Romans 1:16, for I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it's the power of God to salvation to everyone that believeth, right? To the Jew first and also to the Greek. You know, he said, assuredly gather that God has sent me to preach the gospel. Yea, woe is unto me if I what? Preach not the gospel. So the heart of missions is the gospel. What? Go back to what he said. Go back to what he says, and I'll close. He said, we assuredly gathered that the Lord, this is verse 10, had called us for to preach the gospel unto them. To preach the gospel unto them. Listen, as a church and as individuals who make up the church, we have the opportunity to take the gospel to an entire world of people who need the Lord. So I would ask you, has God really nudged your heart? Has God really made it aware to you that you can have a part and that you should have a part in this thing of missions? It begins with the vision. We'll get to the other things, but it starts with the vision, seeing people in need and seeing that God has you in a place that you have the ability that God's given you to make a difference in the lives of people. That's the vision of missions. Would you stand with me tonight? Miss Stephanie, if you'll make your way and come, just play softly on the piano tonight. And maybe you're here and you say, preacher, I've been giving the missions for years and I really don't need to hear all this. Well, maybe that's the case. But maybe tonight you just come and find yourself on an altar and say, Lord, would you give me a renewed zeal? Maybe you're here and you're a little nervous. You say, well, I'm going to be honest with you. Brother Chris, we just can't afford it. We just can't afford it. Listen, I'm not vying for your money. That's not what I'm here to do. But Chris, I just don't see a way, but I know that people need the Lord. Well, maybe tonight you just want to come and pray and say, Lord, would you open up a door? Would you make me aware of a way that I can be involved in this? Maybe it's just to say, Lord, would you open my eyes to the people that's around me? The people that I encounter every day that I walk past in Walmart. Would you help me to genuinely be concerned for people?